athletes village of the Olympic Games, they which we see here in the back, they built before the Olympic Games luxury apartments, and with the image of having hosted the Olympic athletes, it maybe the calculation was that it would rise up the prices for selling. So they used the athletes, they put them inside the apartments, but the athletes were not allowed to touch the real precious and luxurious details. So these details, you know, the neat bath, whatever, bath installations and kitchen ovens, they were covered in caged with surrounded with this material. So that's what the athletes saw. They had maybe the bedroom, but then in the kitchen they saw these boxes. So first there was a material, and then there was the idea.
And then was the idea.
So it's
that's very wrong.
Function follows form. So first there was the form, and then we thought, how the hell can we use this strange material? And there's no experience at all in the world except just protecting luxury apartments from the athletes' approach. We were very long thinking which kind of symbol or icon would be worthy for us to have there as an object that is decomposable, that falls apart. And then we choose the bulldozer.
No, maybe also what is a kind of destructive, it has to do with, I mean, we are here in a vast land, which will get developed one day. And how do you develop a land? Normally you take a bulldozer or a destruction machine and just make tabula rasa, and you push something, you destroy something. Like in a war, people first push everything away, and then something new creates out of it. And so our idea was to use a symbol of this destruction and a symbol for this single-minded power, actually. And so we got to the idea to construct like this machine which will morphize into earth later with the help of a community here, because we will ask people at the opening to bring seeds and to implant seeds in the sculpture, so the sculpture will become a plant nursery in the end. And these new plants can be also used later in the development. We make some tests now at Angora College. Polly Schmidt does tests there with the reed board. So she gets the reed board and puts them in water and puts plants in it.
Reed board is this kind of amazing, relatively new material that's actually made out of compressed reed stock. So it's actually sort of put together almost like particle board or something like that, where it's compressed and tightly packed and then held together with a kind of adhesive. The adhesive isn't formaldehyde based though, so it's actually safer for the environment.
That's good. What did you say? Wheat, the strand?
Yeah, it's actually the stalk.
The stalk, okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. So it actually has kind of a nice kind of golden kind of honey color. So in my own art practice, I work a lot with fungi and mushrooms. And I also have an interest in how things sort of eventually break down and decompose, sort of in a philosophical sense, but also in the actual sense. So there was kind of some nice overlap with my interests and then the interests of Folke and Martin. So they actually asked me to do these different experiments with the wheat board to get a sense of how they were going to break down over time. And so I'm trying out some different conditions. In the first experiment, I had the wheat board sort of submerged in water. Mm-hmm. And so it's been interesting to sort of watch it. It's it has, when I first put it in water, it was starting to kind of fill up with water and kind of bloat out and expand.
Yeah.
And now it's starting to actually break down and decompose. You can see a little bit of mold forming.
The more interesting process, a sculptural process, starts after it's finished. And this process is the decreasing, the composting process, when it falls apart. And nobody knows. We're completely curious how it happens and how fast. Still in the time when I was working in architecture offices, I had the experience of death. Not on myself, but my ex-girlfriend died because of blood cancer. And then the girlfriend of my best friend died half a year later of cancer, and then my best friend died in a car accident. Everything in half a year. So, and my father already died when I was 13. So this experience of death was so fundamentally, I would, for everybody, you know.
Yeah.
What can you say? That of course it had an effect of my life, so it's really it can be over in the next half a year. It's so clear. So how do you spend the rest of your life? And this is maybe the ongoing loop. So what I'm going to do in the next half a year? So it can happen all the time. So I really want to spend the next half a year happy, and to create something which fulfills me, and not wait until I'm retired.
An artifact, which is what we're building right now, is very much a process of different people's idea and different people's from conversations, from argument, from fights even, and then from disagreement and through, you know, learning how to work together and to produce something. So it's like a group effort, and that applies to a lot of design, a lot of product designs. The camera you're holding, the television you're watching, the screen that you're watching comes from a big group of people, and through histories of different conversations and arguments and even failures in the manufacturing process, and then to produce something. So it has history, you know. Everything that we have, all the artifacts that we have in hand in this world, say something about the people who are involved.
There are different ways to work with public space. I mean, you can also create a work, make it in your studio, and then put it out, like we've seen it on sculpture in Kitsiliano. But our work method is very different because we are mostly working on site and site specific. So so the visitors or the pedestrians which walk by and they see the process, because mostly the projects take some time to create. So people also follow the process, so they ask what is going on. And so people are much more already involved in the process than they just would have seen something which is just put there.
Since, let's say, 4 years, we can live from the money that we earn by art, and before we had to do other jobs. And, you know, to have this long endurance to resist, and to, this is so hard. I mean, it's... We managed it somehow. It was a very rational decision that we said, okay, when we want to have any chance on surviving, then we have to reduce all expenses. All. So it's absolutely clear that we cannot consume anymore. So we never go into cinema, we never go into theater, we never buy it. So we used our clothes from 10 years ago. It's absolutely clear, because we want to be artists.
That Folke and Martin had done, where they had used recycled materials from a very large fair. And with the Olympics coming, we thought, well, maybe there was something they could do with some residue from that event. I think there's something really intriguing about working on interim lands, and certainly there are many different kinds of empty lots just sitting waiting for some kind of moment to be developed in the city. And so opening that up, opening up the potential kind of platform.
Have you got enough wood?
I think we've got enough wood, actually.
Of course, my question is, why wouldn't you build something that's going to last?
People in Berlin, we are used that they insult us sometimes, that they make dirty jokes, and we are used. And so this is part of the public space, that we also risk a lot when we are there. That I was once beaten by a guy, but then later we drank a beer together. So to chat with the people, I love it. It's really, and to work with the weather, and in if it's dirty and I come home completely stinky, it's the best thing I can imagine.
I mean, you have to work a lot because you get commission, but in the end, it takes so much longer. When you think first, you think, oh, it's a nice money, amount of money what you get, but in the end, it's like $10 an hour because you work 12 hours in 7 weeks. So, yeah, it's some, well, we can make a living from it, but it's not like we would be rich.
In the end, I don't count the working hours, that it's completely stupid. It's absolutely not comparable with any other regular job what we do. It's the typical precarious work, but on the other side, what we do or what I do is maybe in the best sense that was what the German artist Josef Beuys found out about, you know, the real work, the real fulfilling work that most people find in their hobby. We as artists, we already found what is, you know, what we really want to do, and then we do it. But and then this gives very much back energy and respect and a lot of things that are not valuable by my money.
The bulldozer may change a little bit. I don't know. It seems like every day I show up. We change a little bit because
we don't know how to build yet.
And it includes a lot of improvisation.
Yeah, it includes a lot of improvisation. Like actually every work of us includes a lot of improvisation.
And in the moment, and we in a lot of cases we make our plans, because plans are needed somehow. We make them in the process. So planning and building is happens in the same time.
We covered it, but there were holes in it, so we have no problem. It's already decomposing here. It's just firm, but it will be swirling. And when animals will go in it, already, I really noticed now already animals, like little flies and everything, go in there. And I think we will break it down finally. Yeah. It also smells. I mean, when the tarpaulin was on it, it really smelled. Yeah.
Tell me what it smelled of.
Like stinky feet. It was really funny. It really Where did it happen? It's here. So this one is awesome. Yeah. So this one. So it's really experiment because we don't know how long it will take to decompose. So it's good for living, and it's something because a lot of artists can't, they have to have side jobs, they have to have other jobs to work, so at least we do what we want to do.
Are you getting the same group of volunteers each day, or is it different?
Today we got two extra ones, just some of my own friends, and then they're doing really well, just getting a sense of what needs to be done, and they're on their own. Folke went back to the children, and while I was still in London, the fabulous crew in Chelsea, Gabe and Desmond and Barbara, they went on with the work and they built the shovel. So they went on with working while Folke wasn't here. So I came back and I was completely enthusiastic. I'm still a great job they did.
You'll be working until late tonight, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah, what's that weather, huh?
Weather, yeah.
What's happening?
It's going to decompose.
Is it?
This is all compostable wood.
Yes. Compostable. It's wonderful. That's really Vancouver. I think it needs to be...
Did you live in one of those apartments too?
So hard and so long on the sculpture and all the preparation, and then in the last days you more and more become aware that the vision cannot become true. It's so sad. And so I always was, it was a very, very hard fight to achieve at least something, but there are not at all these details that I wanted to realize. Oh, look, the difference between the cabin on top and the engine cube and the treads. So, originally it was planned that the whole sculpture is detailed like the treads are now. So the treads are very detailed, but... yeah. What can I say? Sometimes we are lucky and sometimes not. Most projects in the end made us happy. So I think in the end it's, I mean with the, now I'm still totally in and it's really this struggle, but I think in a couple of days I will be happy about this.
Back in Berlin, photos, back in Germany.
Yeah. Mm, yeah, and seeing the photos.
The photos will look good.
Yeah.
Don't worry.